Vincent de Paul loved and served Christ and the poor with the proverbial strength of his arms and the sweat of his brow. This love, this charity, gradually transformed him as a young man from being a talented, ambitious, self-centered, and decidedly average priest, making him instead an unforgettable figure in his own age and someone who would be known forever to history as the Apostle of Charity. A saint who, as a brilliant organizer of resources and people, changed the world for the better by doing good and doing it well. When we discover this very human Vincent de Paul on his own terms, we'll also find we've discovered Vincent a relevant and timeless example for all, a saint for all.
The whole context of 17th century France is absolutely essential for understanding Vincent's own personal development as well as the development of his works.
France was being racked by wars of all sorts, either foreign wars or civil wars. It was hardly a year in the whole life of St. Vincent in which France wasn't at war somewhere.
Most of the rest of Catholic Europe had already gone through the reform of the Council of Trent successfully. France is the last major Catholic country to do that because of its political struggles, because of its religious struggles. But it finally does, as the 17th century dawns, get serious about church reform. And Vincent is the right person at the right moment, and he becomes, in his lifetime, as well as to history, the symbol of the successful reformation of the church in France.
The new Bourbon king, Henry IV, was determined that France would be transformed into a united kingdom, led by a powerful king, and able to play a prominent role in European and world affairs.
Henry of Navarre decided that he needed to convert to Catholicism in order to win the people over. He was never a very ardent Protestant, many people think anyway, but he nevertheless was going to be accused of hypocrisy if he just turned around and converted. His conversion really does mark a change in the course of the wars, and ultimately he began an era of rebuilding. And people rallied behind him. He became, it's hard to believe, but by the time he died in 1610, he was one of the most popular kings that France had ever had.
These absolutist policies of one king, one law, one faith were followed by his son Louis XIII and his minister Cardinal Richelieu, and then by the regent Anne of Austria and her minister Cardinal Mazarin, until reaching the height of its splendor under the great Sun King Louis XIV, who famously declared, "L'État, c'est moi," I am the state.
In this system, the church was the state and the state was the church. People believed in the divine right of kings. People believed that the king embodied the state and the church. Vincent had the greatest of respect for the king because the king was the personal symbol of France and the Church of France.
Born in 1581 in the southwest of France, Vincent de Paul came from a peasant family. Growing up in the region of Gascony in a small village called Puy, near the ancient city of Dax.
We do know from some patient investigation that his family owned property. He had members of his family who were in the sort of upper and professional level of local rural life. And so the family were not dirt poor. They had perhaps a six-room house, they owned property, they had animals. He was a normal boy and grew up to be a normal man. I like to think of him, for example, as a young man going to weddings, taking part in parties, singing, dance. Well, he didn't sing very well, apparently, but at least he said that. Dancing, why not? He was an ordinary young man living in the country.
Among their children, Vincent's parents had great hopes for him. Through the only opportunity for any real upward social and economic mobility, a career in the church. So Vincent de Paul was to become a priest.
He was ordained as a young man, 19 or 20 years old, which is certainly far too young. And he seems to have entered the priesthood more from a conviction about using the priesthood as a job, a way to make money, and a way to use that money to take care of his family. Many other people did the same thing.
In 1610, he wrote to his mother and told her that he was seeking a position in Paris and that he hoped that he would soon have enough to come back to her for a comfortable retirement. Now that would make him 29 years of age. Nice to be retiring at 29 years of age. So at that point in life, we're talking about an ambitious young man.
We know, for example, that he gets a position as one of the chaplains in the household of Marguerite de Valois, who was Henry IV's first wife. You don't get a position like that without connections. You don't get a position like that without meeting certain requirements of having a patron.
A series of favorable appointments followed. Pastor of Clichy, then tutor and chaplain to the noble and devout Gondi family. His connections to the highest nobility were now established. His benefices began to accumulate. His fortune and reputation in fashionable Paris society to rise. Vincent's spiritual conversion, beginning at this time, is the element of his biography that is most obscured by myths. This is understandable, given the fact that any person's conversion is ultimately a great mystery.
One of the great temptations in trying to understand Vincent's conversion is to succumb to the model of St. Paul, that the model for conversion is one minute you believe one thing, God knocks you off your horse with a blinding flash of light, and instantaneously Vincent's converted and he spends the rest of his life serving the poor. His conversion was a slow, lifelong process.
It wasn't as if he sat down one day and said, "Now, how can I best give my life to God?" Rather, he reacted to the people and the events that he saw and said, "God is calling me. God is speaking to me through this event, through this person." And that's what changed his life. Not simply sitting back and saying, "How does God want me to change?"
The tenacious hagiographic stories dating back to his first biographer, Bishop Louis Abelly, describe a pious youth. Fabled Tunisian captivity as a Christian slave in North Africa, being falsely accused of theft by a roommate, and suffering a debilitating temptation against faith, resolved finally only by a vow to serve the poor. These accounts are of questionable historical accuracy.
If we read the letters of Vincent, we see they go back to 1607. And so he wrote to his lawyer and told this long story about his captivity in Barbary in northern Africa. And if you read the story, you say either this was a marvelous adventure or it was a big hoax. We don't know. We do know that towards the end of his life, he received a letter from the nephew of his lawyer who was overjoyed to tell Vincent that he had found these two wonderful letters that Vincent had written to his uncle. And Vincent wrote and said, "Send me the letters." From the time Vincent wrote those letters in 1607 until the time he wrote asking for those, and the French says, "ces maudites lettres," these damned letters, he never spoke about the captivity episode.
Myths often are very helpful in helping us to understand what a person is about, just the way occasionally a story or a poem illustrates something better than a history book. And so at times, the myth that is created around a person actually expresses some aspect of their personality very well, even though we might not be sure whether it actually happened or not.
The differences between the Vincent of myth and the Vincent of history essentially have to do with the view of Vincent de Paul that is put together immediately preceding his death, immediately after his death, by people who are absolutely convinced of his sanctity because they had heard his words, they had seen his actions. They're absolutely convinced that eventually the church would recognize that sanctity with canonization. And because so much of the early Vincent was already lost to history because of how long he lived, as they went back to try to recover that, they came across all of these gaps. They filled it in with this projection of sanctity. Vincent grew into sanctity from beginning to end, and when you project it backwards, you lose the essence of how he really became a saint.
Was it providential that his ambition led him to Paris at the dawn of the famous Age of Gold? This remarkable gathering of spiritual giants at one time in one place provided the essential spiritual underpinnings that would direct the successful French Catholic Reformation, as well as support Vincent's own conversion.
It was a time when people thought the world was ending, when they thought God was punishing France. It was a time when many people turned to extreme forms of penitential piety. Processions in the street, barefoot and ashes, changed their behavior, tried to reform society. It was a time of religious anguish.
There was an extraordinary gathering of some of the most important spiritual lights in the entire history of Catholicism. There's this remarkable constellation of brilliant theological thinkers, of deeply insightful spiritual figures who emerge in Paris exactly at this period.
And so he was influenced by schools and people. For example, he was influenced by St. Ignatius of Loyola, the Jesuit spirituality. He was influenced by Bérulle and what would be called the French school of spirituality. He was influenced by Francis de Sales. He was influenced by André Duval. But the final product is very much himself. It's his own. And it's a mixture of things that he felt would be very important in serving the poor.
This new journey would have him follow in the footsteps of Jesus Christ, the evangelizer of the poor and the source and model of all charity. This new journey would at every turn lead him unerringly to people who were poor, spiritually abandoned, and living at the margins.
I can think of no more representative noble family in 17th century France than the Gondis. They are of the highest nobility, just below the royal family. Monsieur de Gondi is general of the galleys of France, and so he is largely absent, fulfilling his naval duties. And so it's really Madame de Gondi who is left behind, essentially as the head of the family.
They were looking for someone to take care of tutoring their children. They wanted a priest, and he moved in with the Gondi family as one of the members of their household.
Vincent was in charge of their education rather than doing it himself. And again, you don't entrust your children, especially three sons, one of whom, of course, is going to be the heir, one, of course, who's going to go to the church, and a spare, as they always said. It's how he ends up being essentially as the spiritual guide or spiritual director of Madame de Gondi.
The Gondis had a lot of property, and they regularly had to go and collect the dues that were owed to them by the people that lived on their properties. In a way, it was like a county government.
And so as Vincent de Paul and Madame de Gondi and their whole household traveled from town to town, from village to village in the Gondi estates, what they witnessed was the spiritual abandonment of the people of the countryside. People who were not well served by their parish, by their priests. They weren't well served in terms of the church being able to give them the sacraments that they needed for this faith life. You know, that fateful January of 1617, Madame de Gondi turns to Vincent and she asks what I have always called the Vincentian question. What must be done? And what she meant by that was, what must I do? What must you do? What must we do about what we are seeing here?
She's also very important to Vincent because she is the one who asked him to hear the confession of this dying peasant whom She considered one of the finest men on her estates, and yet the peasant said to her, "Madame, without this confession, I would have been lost."
And Madame de Gondi said, "Listen, what should we do in a case like this? I'm sure there are many other people on my lands who are in a similar situation. Why don't you preach about this?" Vincent gave this famous sermon that he always called the first sermon of the mission on the 25th of January, 1617, in Fulville. He preached on the necessity of making a good general confession, that is, a confession of the whole of one's life, as far as that's possible, and he did so on this feast day of the conversion of St. Paul. As he said, "God bless my words," people started to come to confession in such numbers that it took him days to finally hear all the people who wanted to go to confession.
And he realized how important this type of ministry was, and so he began to think about forming a community of priests that would give similar missions in the French countryside. And he always, even though he formed the Congregation of the Mission 8 years later, he always referred to that incident as the birth of the Congregation of the Mission.
Vincent's mission would always be about much more than eloquent words preached at a safe distance from a lofty pulpit. It would be about these words made truly eloquent by resolute action, when, where, and how it was needed most. In short, by effective charity.
You have the Fulville experience in January of 1617, and then in the end of 1617, you have the Vincent's experience at Châtillon. They really are the core of everything that's to come. They are what everything has led to, and they then are the point at which everything evolves from.
Living among wealthy people, Vincent himself, who had become like a rich person, realized that this was not where God was calling him. And a few months later, Vincent escaped. He literally escaped from the de Gondi family to go to Châtillon, a parish in southeastern France, on the advice of Bérul, who had been one of his mentors.
And he accepted the parish. He left without saying goodbye, which says something about the difficulty that he felt emotionally of separating himself from the Gondis.
Now, the experts think that perhaps it had just become too much for his conscience that he was living in luxury while the poor were suffering so much. That might be one of the instances also when Vincent wasn't so perfect, because what he did was not exactly worthy of a man in his position at that time as the tutor in the de Gondi family.
There was a dark side to Vincent. I think Vincent himself acknowledged that over and over again, and it wasn't just a false sense of humility.
Vincent himself talks about his weaknesses. He would have black moods. He would go days without speaking. And Vincent himself said he made a retreat and he asked God to free him of his testy, moody disposition. He was also choleric. He had a quick temper. Vincent was a Gascon, and the people of Gascony are very effervescent, if you will, and they did have quick tempers. And Vincent was often apologizing for his own faults, and he did become a very humble man, but it was at great cost to himself.
And I think Vincent himself very well knew and often expressed the great cost of achieving those virtues and the continuing struggle to remain faithful to those virtues until the end of his life.
Well, Vincent's experience in Châtillon was very important because it was there that another incident occurred that made him react.
When a woman of the parish, Madame de Chassaigne, came and told him that there was a family where everyone was sick and that they were very poor, and could they do anything to help? He told the parishioners about this family in need and asked them to do something to help the family.
Again, he said, God bless my words, and the people were so taken by what he had to say that he later said it looked like a procession. There were so many people coming and going, bringing food and help to this family.
And he realized, it's great. It's a great response, but too many people are responding to this one family. So when charity is given, it needs to be organized. And so that was the spark that made him think of organizing conferences of charity, what he called confraternities, in parishes. And he did that all over France, and that spread throughout the world.
What must be done? Charity must be done. How must it be done? Collaboratively, with planning, adequate resources, professionalism, and most of all, with great love and respect for those being served.
The reason I call this question as the Vincentian question, because ultimately I think it crystallizes and provides as much as you can in any single instant a proverbial tipping point in Vincent's life. Vincent, I believe, realizes that this question is his question, and that the answer to this question is his life. The answer to this question is his vocation. Because he understands the question, he is ready to believe in and understand and explore the answer.
After Vincent had been in Châtillon for a very short time, Madame de Gondi pleaded for him to come back. She not only pleaded on her own, she got her husband to plead. She got Cardinal de Bérulle to intercede for her. And Vincent, after much discernment, went back to the de Gondi family, but only on condition that every time he would give a mission on the de Gondi estates, which at that time probably encompassed about 5,000 peasants, every time he gave a mission, he would be allowed also to found a confraternity of charity, so that you have the two aspects, the spiritual and the material care of poor persons.
The period between 1617 and 1625 is absolutely essential. Vincent takes those 8 years to figure out how to institutionalize this mission. And he does that on the Gondi lands. He does that in their parishes, in the parishes that they are responsible for.
Vincent realized that in order for him and his followers to do what Christ did, they had to become more like Christ, whom Scripture revealed as being the evangelizer of the poor and the source and model of all charity.
He was disgusted by seeing certain people who were so poor and so deprived that he says they didn't even look human. But he said, if I turn this medal around, I realize that there's the figure of Jesus in this poor person. So he had a great love of the poor, but a great love of all people because they were human beings. They were his sisters and his brothers, and he wanted them to exercise as best they possibly could their own roles in the church.
Vincent was always urging people to try to find out, what is God asking me concretely today? And to ask, Lord, what do you want me to do today? How do you want me to respond? How do you want me to love today? How do you want me to speak to the people whom I have to speak with?
One of his sayings was, what would the Son of God do on this occasion? So that prayer inhabited him, so to speak, but it was always a prayer that was associated with service. It was mission and charity, body and soul, spirituality and action.
He would say that there's a missionary spirituality, and that every missionary should have 5 characteristic virtues: simplicity, humility, gentleness, mortification, and zeal.
When we talk about these virtues that Vincent talks about, what I believe, first of all, we need to do is to translate them. Vincent speaks them in a 17th century idiom in language which I don't think is particularly helpful without translation in the 21st century. I translate virtues as values. So for example, I would say that Vincent's virtue of simplicity is accurately translated as his value of honesty. Zeal is translated as the value of being hardworking. Being meek is translated as the value of being approachable. Being humble is translated as the value of being reasonable. Vincent's virtue of being mortified, I translate as the value of being self-disciplined.
Vincent never underestimated how difficult these personal virtues were to acquire and maintain. But he knew they were indispensable to the success of the mission, and so do his followers. As Vincent once said, God asks first for your heart, and only then for your work. He saw that changes were urgently needed, but where and how to begin, toward what expected outcome, with what means, and with whose help.
Vincent believed that God had a plan, and that it's important for us to try to discern that plan. And he realized that that took time. It took the time to listen to people, to listen to events, to dialogue back and forth. One of his famous phrases is that grace has its moments and that we shouldn't step on the heels of providence. We shouldn't be rushing providence. We should take our time in making decisions. But once they're made, we should move ahead firmly.
Vincent, of course, believed clearly in divine providence and that our role in life was to do God's will. And God laid out his will for us in every moment of our life.
He has a beautiful saying in which he says that there's no better way to assure our eternal happiness than to live and die in the service of the poor, in the arms of providence, renouncing ourselves in order to put on Jesus Christ. So he believed deeply in providence.
What must be done? The church must be renewed and reformed. Founded in Paris in April 1625 with a generous endowment provided by his noble patrons, Monsieur and Madame de Gondi, the Congregation of the Mission, a community of priests and brothers following Christ, evangelizing and serving the poor, would become Vincent's most important contribution to the reform of the French Catholic Church.
If you were to look at all of Vincent's activities as a reformer of the church, they are all institutionalized in the Congregation of the Mission. The mission is the reform, parish by parish, of the church. And you can't reform the parish without reforming the priest.
The clergy at St. Vincent's time was very poorly instructed. Vincent says that some of them didn't even know the formula for absolution and confession. They would have to read it off a piece of paper. And they made all sorts of mistakes in celebrating Mass and so on, because there was no really set way of forming priests. There were no seminaries at that time in France. And so he decided that something had to be done for the reform of the clergy. He was not alone in this.
He told his confreres at one point that some bishops had a meeting, and each one was complaining about the lives of the clergy in their dioceses. One of them said, "Out of all the priests in my diocese, not one is sober or chaste." Now, this is probably an exaggeration, but it at least gives you a flavor of the difficulties.
I think that we would be naive to believe that everyone liked Vincent. I think it's clear that not everyone appreciated Vincent's activities and Vincent's influence, because it was largely, perhaps, at their expense. In 1625, when the Congregation of the Mission is founded, it's Vincent and five other priests. By 1628, when it is still just a handful of priests, Vincent is asking for legal recognition from the king so that the mission of the Congregation of the Mission can expand from the Gondi lands to the entire kingdom. At the same time, Vincent is already writing to the Pope to get validation of the Congregation of the Mission for the entire church, because Vincent's vision already is that this mission is not just on the Gondi lands, this mission is not just in the Archdiocese of Paris, this mission is not just in the Kingdom of France, but this is the mission of the church.
Vincent's vision for the scope of the mission of the Congregation of the Mission, spreading from the Gondi lands to the Archdiocese of Paris to all of France and beyond, would soon be confirmed by the actions of divine providence. His nascent community received royal approval by Louis XIII in 1627 and papal approval by Urban VIII in 1633. These approvals set the stage for the next development, the acquisition of a powerful base for the community's ministries. The ancient priory of Saint-Lazare, located just outside the gates of Paris on the Rue Saint-Denis.
Vincent acquired Saint-Lazare as the mother house of the Congregation of the Mission. It is the largest ecclesiastical property in the region of Paris. It means it's wealthy, it's powerful, it's influential. It had been run by a group of Augustinian monks for centuries, but at the dawn of the 17th century, the monastery, the priory, had been reduced to just a handful of monks, and they no longer had the energy or the manpower to fulfill the responsibilities. And the last prior, Adrien Le Bon, looked around and said, what am I going to do with this? And he looked at Vincent de Paul, looked at the new Congregation of the Mission, and said, what better use than dedicating this to church reform, dedicating this to something that is living and vibrant. And so out of the blue, he approaches Vincent and says, how would you like it?
It must, as St. Vincent admitted, been like a clap of thunder or a cannon blast to him. He was just dumbstruck by the fact of having to take on this huge, huge piece of property with everything that was involved in it. The houses, the buildings, the lands, the farms, the mills, and so on. And he said, no. He said, I just can't do it. But eventually, some of his friends said, listen, this is the great opportunity. And so after a great deal of hesitation and a great deal of prayer and consultation, he agreed to take on Saint-Lazare.
I think the acquisition of Saint-Lazare as the mother house of the Congregation of the Mission is a very, very crucial step. And although Vincent resisted it at first, I think in the end he came to realize that in its vastness, in its wealth, in its power, in its rights, in its responsibilities, it would give him the platform and would give the Congregation of the Mission a platform to grow into.
It changed the congregation from being this little band of brothers who would leave the key under the mat or give the key to their neighbors and go out and preach and then come back, into a fully developed religious congregation.
Within Vincent's lifetime, these and other efforts successfully reformed the church in France, so that the church as it existed at Vincent's death in 1660 was all but unrecognizable from the church that had existed at the dawn of the century when he had been ordained. Vincent de Paul became the symbol of the Catholic Reformation in France, and his successful efforts on behalf of reform and the poor led to a national role and influence for him, recognized and rewarded by the crown.
He did believe in the divine right of kings. He was a man of his time, the absolute monarchy of the 17th century. So he was always respectful of the role of the rich and powerful, even at the time when he was working for the rights of poor persons. And you can see that in his letters.
If Vincent de Paul was notable for his unquestioning acceptance of authority, he was also notable for his unflinching and prophetic calls for all hierarchical authority to live up to its responsibilities. Failure to do so, by king or noble, by pope, bishop, or priest, would ultimately be judged by God, awarded and punished appropriately with consequences for all eternity, creating leverage with these authorities for Vincent. Vincent's comfort with authority as it existed in his world gave him the power to ensure that it was used in the service of a shared faith, the common good, and most of all, the poor. What must be done? People who are poor and abandoned must be served whenever and wherever they're found. Standing at Vincent's side, but not in his shadow, was another remarkable saint, his decades-long friend, spiritual directee, and trusted collaborator, Louise de Marillac, Mademoiselle Lagrave.
It seems to me that in order to know Vincent de Paul fully, you also have to know Louise de Marillac, with whom he worked so closely for 35 years. Louise came from a very well-to-do family, but she had a very unhappy childhood. She was illegitimate. She never knew her mother. Her father remarried, and her stepmother never accepted her. So she never knew the warmth of family life. She was brought up in the Royal Dominican Convent of Poissy.
She's growing up, and it's becoming a time when she has to make a life decision. And she's attracted to the cloister. She has contact with the Superior General of the Capucines, the women, an Honoré de Champigny. And he says to her, seemingly with no further explanation, "No, God has other designs on you." Now, in hindsight, that was prophetic, but to a 15-year-old girl, it was devastating. So she either entered the cloister, and that was the only form of religious life at the time, or she marries. Her husband, Antoine Lagrave, was a secretary to the Queen Mother, Marie de Medici. Louise, for the first time in her life, was in a family environment, and she had a child who was going to be the joy of her life and the sorrow of her life. But her husband becomes ill, Michelle becomes a problem, and Louise de Marillac does what Louise de Marillac always does. She blames herself.
Louise had a sort of lumière, or her light of Pentecost, while she was praying. She was coming out of a depression. She seemed to hear or to see this illumination, this light, where God was telling her about her future. And one of the things that was in this illumination, this light of Pentecost, was that she would have to take a new director, but it would be repugnant for her to accept him.
How they actually met is a big unknown. What is certain is that neither of them was happy about it. Vincent is, say, we're getting into 1625 and the founding of the Congregation of the Mission. This is what Vincent is focused on. And suddenly, someone comes along and asks him to take over the spiritual direction of a woman who's going through a crisis. And he's not real happy. And then you have Louise, who is accustomed to Jean-Pierre Camus, and suddenly it's this country priest who is going to be her spiritual director.
After a while, Vincent began to recognize the exceptional qualities in Louise, and he thought that the best thing for her would be to become involved in serving other people so that she would forget about herself and her own miseries. So he invited her to work in the confraternities of charity.
In an age that assumed women were weaker, if not inferior, to men, and which put strict limitations on their public roles and responsibilities, Vincent, together with Louise de Marillac and a whole host of other like-minded, devout women, successfully pioneered many new roles of leadership and service for women via the Ladies of Charity, and most importantly, via the Daughters of Charity.
The Ladies of Charity were intended always to go into the charity hospitals to talk to the patients, to offer consolation to the patients, especially to urge them to go and confess. Many people in the hospitals those days were going to die. These are not hospitals that you got well from. They're often places that you were not going to get well from. And so for a good devout Catholic to make sure that these people confessed themselves, received absolution, was extremely important. And that's what the real mission of the Ladies of Charity was.
While the Ladies of Charity provided noble women in familial roles an outlet for expressing their leadership through the exercise of charity, the Daughters of Charity represented a radical new form of consecrated life for single women in the Catholic Church, one that was not limited to what could be done safely and comfortably by elite nuns secluded behind high and impenetrable cloister walls. Rather, the Daughters of Charity would find their cloister in the streets as they welcomed young women from the countryside who wanted to serve the poor and sick wherever and whenever they were found and however they needed to be served.
Religious life wasn't just cloister active. It was also wealthy. It was restricted to the wealthy, to those who could pay substantial dowries. And so they have created something without that and have brought a whole group of people into the religious life who would never, ever have had access to it before. Louise de Marillac says, dare we hope for such a thing? And she did dare. They all dared.
Marguerite Nazo was a peasant girl from the little village of Suresnes, and she had heard about Vincent and had seen the works of the confraternity, probably in her own parish. So she herself went to Vincent and asked him if she could be one of these volunteer serving girls. And Vincent marveled at her, and he considers her the first Daughter of Charity. Unfortunately, Marguerite died of the plague in 1632, before the Company of the Daughters of Charity was actually founded.
Vincent de Paul said, okay, if we're going to institutionalize charity and make it professional and keep it human, we need a core of people who can dedicate themselves to that.
And on November 29th, 1633, this small group, perhaps four of these volunteer women, came together with Louise, and that was the foundation of the Daughters of Charity.
Louise chose a scriptural motto for the new community taken from 2 Corinthians, Caritas Christi Urget Nos. However, she added an all-important editorial addition. The charity of Jesus Christ crucified urges us. Service not only in response to the needs of brothers and sisters in Christ, but urgent service in response to the suffering of brothers and sisters in Christ.
So that at the beginning of the 17th century, the dominant theme is the penitential piety, with charity taking place. As you go along, the penitence becomes less important, more internalized, into a kind of self-discipline, and the outgoing charity, service to others, becomes the dominant mode. Some of this is also the change from the wars of religion to the wars of the Fronde, to a different kind of civil war, but a civil war that is accompanied by a new kind of poverty, of new kind of destruction, so that the charitable service is really extremely necessary.
Vincent and his followers nimbly responded to these shifts and through bold experimentation provided new and effective models of service, as evidenced in the care of the foundlings.
The number of abandoned children increases exponentially in this era because of political factors, because of economic factors, because of the war, because of famine, because of all those interlocking poverties that conspire to give women little choice but then to abandon children to the hope that they would be cared for. And Vincent was up against some very clear prejudices.
The care of the foundlings was terrible in Paris at the time. And the Ladies of Charity were reluctant to help because foundlings were looked upon as children of sin.
And Vincent cut through all of that and said, none of that makes any difference. Where these children came from, how they got to be born, how they got to be abandoned, none of that makes any difference at all. All that makes a difference is that abandoned child laying there is your child.
They have accepted these children as their responsibility, and their acceptance is confirmed by their donations, which will make the rescue of foundlings possible and successful. Similarly, there were also the galley convicts. From 1619, Vincent served as Chaplain General of the Galleys of France. The Mediterranean fleet consisted of galleys whose mission was to protect the French coastline from marauding Barbary pirates. In order to provide the manpower needed for these ships, a common criminal punishment was to be sentenced to servitude as a galley rower.
Vincent came in contact with them and was horrified by what he saw. He said, there are these poor prisoners who are being treated worse than animals. And that involved him in trying to take care of their spiritual as well as their physical well-being. These men were abandoned and left to their own devices. They could get food only if somebody brought them food and if they could buy the food. Some were able to, some were not able to, and were left in the most miserable sort of conditions, and he wanted to do something about it.
Vincent never challenged the judicial system that had condemnation to service on the galleys as a punishment. His view was this was the legal system, this was a legitimate punishment for legitimate crimes. But what he did challenge was, okay, whether they are convicts or not, no matter what their crime, no matter what they've been convicted for, they're still children of God. They're still our brothers and sisters.
So he was able gradually to find a new place to put them. Their conditions in their former prison were just despicable, and was able to get the Ladies of Charity and the Daughters of Charity some years later to work for the galley prisoners in Paris.
As Vincent organized the Congregation of the Mission, the Daughters of Charity, the Ladies of Charity, and the Confraternities of Charity, as answers to the question, what must be done, he began in each case with a clear vision based on experience of what their mission needed to be. But he had a very novel approach at establishing the organizing rules that would govern and guide their efforts.
At the very beginning, St. Vincent did not start with rules. He knew some few basic principles. One was that we will not charge for our missions. The second thing was that we would live together in a community. Third, we would put all of our money together in a common purse. Fourth, we would have time for prayer. Things like this, simple things. He eventually put those together in a very short series of rules.
He just didn't write them down and have them live them. He had them live them first, and then they were written down. That's why he said so many times, this is my faith, this is my experience.
His later years were the years of maturing on the level of reflection, because he only published the rule for the Congregation of the Mission 2 years before he died, in 1658. So the congregation had been in existence since 1625, so it had existed for 33 years before he actually felt that he was ready to publish its rule.
Those are quite developed and quite beautiful, because they show St. Vincent working with these initial inspirations that he had and filling them out with theological and Christological perspectives, and those then became the common rules that have guided the congregation since that day.
Vincent also understood that in order for the mission to be successful, it would always require significant financial support from government, grants, endowments, gifts, and contributed services. After all, no money, no mission.
I think Vincent was an enormously attractive personality. And so I think people were drawn to him. And often wealthier women were drawn to him because they saw the good that he was doing among the poor. And they came and were willing to help. Or he would go to them and ask them if they were willing to help, and they would help.
What I think is remarkable with Vincent's relationship with the Ladies of Charity was the way he encouraged them to give money and to give time. He came and he did conferences for them, he gave them talks, and as you read those, every one of them is an encouragement to persist, to continue, but also kind of chiding, you know, you haven't given as much now. I saw it as a kind of beginning of a modern fundraising campaign.
The genius of Vincent, again, was at the level of how do we make this work? How do we make this effective? I often describe him as a classic chief executive officer, but I also describe him as a classic chief information officer, chief communication officer, chief operating officer. Vincent was good at all of these executive skills because he took these natural talents and put them at service of a mission that was bigger than himself, a mission that was of transcendent importance.
Vincent and Louise lived much longer than most of their contemporaries. In 1659 and 1660, both of them were very sick. Vincent had many illnesses, and at this time he was probably bedridden in St. Lazare. They only lived across the street from one another. So at this point in their lives, they're both thinking about eternity. But Louise writes one poignant letter where she says, "I ask only one favor, the only thing that has been my consolation for the last 35 years was her relationship with Vincent, and could he come once more to see her?" No answer. Early in 1660, she wrote a second letter asking, "Could he not come to see her?" No answer. He sent a brother over to Louise. He said, "Tell her that she is going first, and that if God permits, I will rejoin her in heaven." And people say, "Well, how could he be that harsh on her?" But he was sick himself. He probably couldn't come. Or perhaps maybe the parting was as difficult for him as it was for her. But they remained very close friends, even to their death, and I think it's significant that they both died in the same year, 1660.
I think my favorite Louise de Marillac quote, and I have many favorites, is one that comes very late in her life. And she talks about prayer, her personal prayer, and she concludes with, "No thoughts, no resolution. God will do what he desires." And that's the summary of the journey. The woman who has moved to the letting go. And that's the Vincent and Louise relationship.
I don't think people realize the effect that Louise had on Vincent. We often hear of how much Vincent did for Louise. But she was actually a soulmate for Vincent. They were both pioneers in charity. They worked very closely, and they could have been drawn to one another. But instead, together, their look was outward on God and on poor persons. Louise died on March 15, 1660, in July of 1660, Vincent felt well enough to speak to the daughters. They came to him. He couldn't go to them. He said that in the 35 years that he had known her, he had never seen a speck of imperfection in her. He did say that she had little flights of impatience. That's the only negative thing that he said about her.
Early in the morning of September 27th, 1660, after a long period of slowly declining health, the aged Vincent de Paul died quietly in his room at Saint-Lazare, surrounded by members of his community. He was buried the next day in a crypt in the nave of the community chapel.
The last moments of St. Vincent, fortunately, have been preserved for us by one of his confreres, who kept a journal. At the very end, they had a fire in his room, and he was seated, completely clothed, and was surrounded by his confreres, who asked him for his blessing. But he finally just grew tired and said, "This is enough." And they just sort of left him alone, helped him in prayer, and he died. Said it was just like blowing a candle out.
Those who surrounded the dying Vincent and the many who heard the news of his death were convinced that they mourned the passing of a saint. His reputation for holiness was one that they had bestowed based on what they had heard him say, what they had seen him do for so many years, with the remarkable results that had changed their world for the better.
The preacher at his funeral said he just about changed the face of the church. And so, in his 79 years of life, he did enormous works which have lasted right up till today.
When Vincent dies on September 27th, 1660, all of his followers, everyone who knew him, were convinced that he was a saint. They also knew that the church required a cooling off period, that it would be decades before they could officially start his cause. But what they also realized was that they couldn't let that time just be fallow. And so they were starting up this campaign for Vincent's canonization that would solidify who he was in historical memory as the basis for the canonization process that was still decades away.
For a long time now, we've used the term Vincentian family to refer to that large group of people who look to St. Vincent as a kind of spiritual guide and model. It, of course, includes the Congregation of the Mission, the Daughters of Charity, the Ladies of Charity, the Society of St. Vincent de Paul, and many other groups. It seems to me that the truth of the Vincentian family and its validity finally will be to be able to follow Jesus, the evangelizer of the poor, in the same way that St. Vincent did and taught.
But I think what we have to realize is that what's captured by that adjective Vincentian is not just Vincent de Paul, but that adjective must be broad enough to include Louise de Marillac, because that adjective Vincentian is meaningless without her. That somehow it was her insights, it was her faith, it was her experience, and the contributions of her role together with Vincent, which combined to create this reality that we still label with this adjective Vincentian.
Well, I think Vincent de Paul is very much a saint for today. He's practical, he's concrete, he's effective in his service of the poor. He's very concerned that we would minister to the poor in a way that will change their lives.
It has been nearly four centuries since Vincent walked among us. The world has changed dramatically and with increasing rapidity under the forces that govern history. The example of Vincent de Paul and of Louise de Marillac inspired each succeeding generation to ask and to answer the Vincentian question: what must be done? What must we do to serve people who are poor and to advocate for justice and systemic change against the forces that create and sustain such poverty and suffering?
At the dawn of the 21st century, we know what's at stake in the world around us, and we also know who is paying the highest price for the world that we live in, and it's people who are poor. How can this Vincentian reality not just be a Catholic thing or not just be a Christian thing, but be something which can be a highest common denominator that unites Catholics and Protestants and Orthodox and Jews and Muslims and Buddhists and Hindus, agnostics and atheists, around the shared values of advocacy and service on behalf of those who are most marginalized and most abandoned? And perhaps if we can have this be our highest common denominator that begins conversations rather than ends conversations, hopefully this can become a common ground to address other critical issues facing our world today.
There are poor people living at the margins everywhere. And if we allow ourselves to see them, we can also hear Vincent de Paul ask his question, what must be done?
Make it through. This is the sound of